Island in the rainy. She got a jig on strong. It's so good to be here. Okay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first time we're ever doing a webinar type panel discussion for the Marketing and Communications Committee at BritCham. I'd like to welcome everybody who has joined us this morning. This is really awkward not having any audience feedback whatsoever. I assume that everybody can hear me. I assume that everybody can see me, hopefully in the top right-hand corner of your screen. And I am going to start off today by introducing myself. My name's Andrew Clark. I am the co-chair of the Marketing and Communications Committee here at BritCham. And I am also a partner at a creative video agency called AsiaWorks. And we have offices all over the Southeast Asia region. And I am here to mediate and host the event today. The Marketing and Communications Committee at BritCham, our job is mainly to ensure that all of our members and all of the members of the other business committees, our community, are updated and kept in touch and made aware of best practice in the MarCom sector, both globally and here in Singapore. And I think at this particular moment in time, it's more important than at any other moment in time. And we've been acutely aware in our committee how we really can be a resource of help, advice to the community at BritCham. And that's one of the major reasons why we're holding this event today. We have already put out a couple of pieces of content around marketing and communications during COVID. And our hope is today, with our absolutely amazing panel, our stellar panel of people who we're extremely grateful of having with us, to be here to have a discussion ourselves and then put it out there for you guys to ask us questions. And you can ask questions and put questions in at any time into the Q&A, which you'll see at the bottom of your screens. The next thing that I need to do is to thank our sponsors, the Fry Group, who are very graciously helping support this and other events at the Chamber. And I will just make myself full screen now. There we go. And I want to move on to let you know that also we're going to be doing a poll during this panel, and I'm going to switch the poll on now. So if you look at the bottom of your screens, you will see a poll. And what we would like you to do is to choose an appropriate piece of music for us to play out on. We thought that it might be something nice for you to think about during the time that we do this. So I'll play you little snippets of each of the pieces of music, if I can find them. Just give me one second. Here we go. So first up, you have the choice. So we'll play this piece of music at the end when we finish. So the first piece of music you have the choice of is this one. Where are we? Young teacher, that's The Police. Don't Stand So Close to Me. Fantasy. That's choice number one. Choice number two. That's great. It starts with an earth. It's REM. The End of the World as We Know It. Choice number three. Let's whiz on a little bit. There we go. Things can only get better. Choice number four.
some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad.
Always look on the bright side of life.
When you're chewing on life's gristle.
And the final choice.
Give a whistle.
Where is it?
Truth is, I thought it mattered.
There we go. And that's the final choice. So you're only allowed to choose one, and you've got the whole of the panel to choose one. Okay, enough of that. Let's stop that, and let's get back to what we're here for today. Okay, so first of all, I'd like to introduce our panel for today. I have introduced myself. I need to bring up another slide. So I've introduced myself. My name is Andrew Clark. I'm a partner at AsiaWorks. We're a creative video agency. Next, we have Luke. Now, Luke Delauzun is actually also a member of our Marketing and Communications Committee. He works at the law firm Simmons & Simmons. He's been based in Singapore for 4 years. And he's the head of marketing for APAC here, marketing and business development at Simmons & Simmons. And he is responsible for crafting campaigns that raise awareness while providing additional value to existing clients beyond typical legal services. And he's a very active member of our community and has been behind events that we're running. But also I think that his voice in our discussion today is really important because he's going to be giving us some great insight on a case study level of what it's been like as a marketer in a company dealing with what's been going on. I think that's going to be really, really useful for us all today. Then we have Iain Twine. Now, Iain has had a salubrious career. He's an economist and political scientist, former CEO of Edelman in Southeast Asia. He's a real expert, a proper grown-up expert in the area of crisis communications, and at the moment is heavily involved with a number of clients here in Singapore, advising them as they deal with various issues as a result of the fallout of COVID. And we'll be talking with him about that. He's also part of an organization in the area of esports. And we'll be finding out a little bit more about that later on as well, because I think that as we all start to live our lives more online, things like esports are really important. And I think that his insight into that will be really interesting. Suzy Goulding, who is the business unit director at MullenLowe Salt Singapore. Suzy is the chair of our marketing and communications committee. Suzy is has a lot of experience and is very highly skilled in the area of employee engagement, employee communications, and strategic communications. And her voice is going to be absolutely essential to our conversation today. I think that especially when we get to the Q&A, I think that Suzy's voice will be really important in letting us know a bit about what she's seeing with her clients, but also at the same time, you know, best practice and strategies for how we talk to people about some of the things that are going on at the moment. She's got 20 years communications experience. And her passion is leading and inspiring teams to produce engaging and effective communications. Next, and finally, we've got Julia Wei. She has just started as managing partner at AKA Asia. Congratulations. And Julia has had a long career here in Singapore working with top agencies. She started at Edelman, then she moved on to the Secret Little Agency, where she helped expand its operations. Most recently, she was working at Lazada, and she literally this week has joined AKA Asia as the managing partner. And we're really excited to have her on the panel today, because she is going to be able to give us some really good insight into social media, but also the way that brands are communicating at the moment. And again, best practice and discussion around that. I think that also she's prepared a few slides for us to look at, which are going to be quite interesting as well. So that is our panel. And I am going to move now into starting the discussion by pushing various numbers, buttons. So what would be great, panel, is if you could all switch on your video so we can all have a look at you. There's Luke, there's Suzy, and there's Julia, and there's Iain. So hopefully all of you at home watching will be able to see them in a gallery view. So what I'm going to do now is switch to this view. And I think that what would be great is to start off with Luke, to try and set the scene here, and give us a sense of what's been going on. So hi, Luke.
Good morning. Well, it's been a wild couple of months. I guess to walk everyone through my experience, and I hope many people on this call today will kind of relate to the experience that I've had. But I'd like to kind of break it down into a few stages. So initially, when things kind of kicked off a few months ago now, it was more of a kind of minor blip in our kind of marketing BD approach. Things were postponed in terms of events and campaigns. Obviously, we had restricted travel, but otherwise it was largely business as usual. Then we kind of moved into a realization that this wasn't going to be something that was over soon. And planning kind of began in terms of how we were going to actually kind of go to market with the kind of the new normal, as it's often referred to. So we started kind of farming out ad hoc content, pushing out to clients as the situation developed. And then the kind of the next stage was that obviously COVID was classified as a pandemic, and the rest of the world suddenly was involved, and certainly working at a UK headquartered law firm. I wouldn't want to say that things weren't taken kind of fully on board until it became a global issue, but certainly when the UK and the Europe was kind of pulled into this, the global business realized that we needed to have a more coordinated approach, a reduction of kind of comms, improved structure, and we kind of adjusted our marketing strategy, our objectives and budget, also looking at how the kind of capacity was allocated across the global business. So we set up a COVID working group to make sure that kind of everything that we were doing was coordinated and not kind of clients getting hit from all directions. And then kind of the current stage that we're in is kind of developing our service offering to kind of suit the new world. So the type of work that we're doing is shifted somewhat, but we're now getting clients actually kind of coming to us for kind of online training in regards to the kind of ramifications of COVID-19. So that's where we are now. Who knows where we're heading?
Luke, what does that mean for the marketing objective? So you know, obviously there's been a massive change in the way that you're operating now, and previously before COVID you would have had objectives for marketing in terms of perhaps making more money for the company, bottom line. But what are those objectives now? Have you got a clear strategy? Have you got a clear objective in terms of what your role as a marketer is now?
Well, I guess our aspirations largely remain the same. We're still trying to make lots of money where we can. I think the main thing that's shifted is, what was achievable 3 months ago when we started kind of doing our plans for the year, in some respects is now certainly not the case. In terms of our shift, in terms of Simmons, we're focusing a lot more on existing clients rather than kind of aggressively going for new business across kind of new regions or new markets. We're taking care of the clients that we have, making sure we're kind of keeping in close contact in a time where obviously we're not able to go in and meet face to face, which certainly for me in a law firm is quite an important part of kind of growing and nurturing these relationships. So that's a big thing. I guess the other way that our objectives have been impacted is we're quite focused around kind of content and campaigns that are planned well in advance. Obviously, any sort of content calendar's gone out the window, and with that, any objectives that were tied to those campaigns. So we're having to be very kind of flexible and adjusting things kind of month by month. And then, yeah, with that, I guess financial forecasts in some areas of the business, we're actually doing quite well. I guess the good thing, law firms generally do pretty well in times of crisis. Certainly parts of the business have probably taken a hit, but certainly in dispute resolution, employment, our kind of debt restructuring and those sort of segments are doing quite well.
So in terms of the way that you mentioned content there, it's going to be quite an important part of the discussion that we're having today. But in terms of developing content, okay, content plans are out of the window and new content needs to be created. Are you doing that all yourself? You're doing that all by yourself? Have you found that there are people out there who can help you, who have an expertise in this area? How are you producing content at the moment?
Yeah, I guess it's a bit of a mix. Like many many firms, obviously our marketing is one of the first kind of parts of a business that is assessed when budgets are hard, and I guess in more traditional business you're seen as a cost to the business, which isn't always fair, but it means that there's extra scrutiny. So we still have a number of agencies that support us in the kind of areas of PR, some cases kind of video content. It's the main shift. We still have that support, and we're not looking to cut it out. I think that would be a kind of short-sighted way to approach things. But what we are doing is having kind of honest conversations with the agencies that we work with, saying, look, budgets are going to be tough for the next few months. Kind of how are we going to make better use of our time with you? In elements like video content, good example, we were recently planning a kind of a new product kind of promotional film, would have involved a number of our lawyers talking about the new service, new product, on camera, a few location shoots and things like that are obviously impossible now. So instead of doing that, we're working with an agency to produce kind of more animation content that's kind of narrated, easy to farm out on platforms like LinkedIn. The amount of work that we're going to be doing with external parties hasn't changed. Talking about kind of a capacity within our team, we're certainly not going to be making big hires in the next few months. And I think agencies provide quite a nice kind of flexible option to kind of fill the capacity gaps as and when you need them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's flexibility is something that we're all looking for at the moment.
Yeah, I think I totally agree with you. I mean, certainly in terms of our relationships with clients, it's been a lot of calls like this where the sentiment is we've never done anything like this before, or can you advise us on this and can we have a chat about that? Very much so. Thank you very much indeed, Luke. We'll come back and talk to you a bit later on. I'd like to move on to Iain to have a talk about what you're up to at the moment, Iain. So why don't you give us a sense of what you're doing right now in Singapore with this crisis that's happening?
Yep. Good morning, and thanks for having me. It wasn't until I started using Zoom I realised how many chins I've got. one of the things that I'm now onto my 18th case in the last 2 months in terms of COVID-19 and dealing with responses for businesses, buildings and the CBD across Singapore. So I've sort of seen quite a lot of how it all works. And what I wanted to talk about today was sort of what does that 24, 48 hour timeline look like if you get hit? So let's sort of run it through as a, you know, you wake up on a Monday morning, and this changes slightly now that we're all in lockdown, but pre-lockdown I'll go through that and then give you some ideas on what will happen potentially in the next 30 days. Say you wake up on a Monday morning and an employee says, listen, I've been quarantined at 9 a.m. on a Monday morning, and off they go and they go through all the process with MOH and all of the great stuff that Singapore's doing. What happens next for your organization? What does that timeline look like from an internal and external perspective? So generally, if you say at a building level, so most of us are operating, you know, not in standalone buildings. We've got other tenants in there who are from other businesses. You know, we've got a floor or half a floor or whatever else you might be, and there's 20, 30, 100 or thousands of other people working in those buildings. The building owners will first, you know, you have to, there's a process between say 9 to 11 in the morning of which you go through and you identify and you communicate to a variety of different stakeholders, all internally broadly at this point in time, and government. So what's been happening is businesses themselves will talk to the building owners and they'll say it's happened. The building owner will then go through a process of a couple of things. So first off, the business will evacuate the floor. They will talk to all of their staff. They will put out a circular or an email or a WhatsApp to all staff explaining that they have to evacuate and leave the floor. And then the business itself will then start doing internal communications to its shareholders, its investors, its partners, trying to push out sort of business continuity or actually just what's happening and what they're going through. The building owner itself will then put out a circular to the rest of the people within in that complex, say one building or multiple buildings. And that circular will talk about when that individual was in the office, last in the office, what floor they were working on, and they won't try not to say what business they're in. And because we really don't want to try and name and shame at this point in time. And then the building owner and the business themselves will have a communications with Ministry of Health. So that's your sort of first 2 hours of this is happening. Once you've put out that circular, either as a business or as a building owner, that has been leaked within those 2 hours. 100% everything I've seen and written in the last month has been leaked within a couple of hours. And that's generally us, you know, people, because we're humans, we will take an image of that and share it on WhatsApp to our friends, bugger, we're off home, someone's got it in the office. And then that just spreads like wildfire. And interesting, yesterday, the government arrested a civil servant who took an image of a press release from Friday in the morning, which said that they were going to shut the schools. And so that leak has now ended up that she took a photo of that leak, of that press release, sent it to WhatsApp to her husband. Her husband shared it with her, all their friends, and the pair of them are now under the guise of Singapore prisons, an enjoyable experience, no doubt, for them. So between 9 and 11, you've got this sort of information flow that's happening, and it starts to leak. And then what happens then? So the media is then going to start calling you. And normally in a crisis or an issue, we would be trying to be as quickly and responsive as we possibly can with the media, because we want to own, shape and control what the narrative might be about our organization. In the case of COVID-19, my sort of advice and experience is we delay, because what's happening to you at say between on a Monday morning is probably happening and is happening to 10 to 15 other organizations. And by the time, you know, you've got your media statement ready to go, there has been a death, there has been 100 new cases, there's been a new cluster. So you don't want to be feeding that media agenda throughout that day and responding directly. So you sort of delay those questions and responses to the journalists. And the reason why you're doing that is because of the timeline that Singapore government has implemented and the change in the sort of media ecosystem timeline. Like generally, we would always sort of be operating on by 3 o'clock, most papers and publications are trying to put to bed the stories and the articles for that evening or for the next day. In the current case, you've got in Singapore through the task force, there's 2 major updates a day. So we've moved from being one WhatsApp, and I hope everyone's on the MOH WhatsApp group where you get that information. A month ago, we were getting one a day, and that was coming between 7 and 9 p.m. And that was coming after the task force had done their press conference and they'd had their daily update meeting. It was also coming between that time because that's how long it takes to just work out how many new cases, do some of the contact tracing around those cases and identify what had happened in Singapore on that daily basis. So normally we would be sort of trying to fill in that time, respond to media in that sort of 11 to 3, 8 p.m. timeframe and getting our position, our statement out there. The reality is that you can hold off on this or not respond at all until well after that evening press conference, because what's been driving the daily coverage is the Singapore government update. You know, it's not been an identification of a cluster or response from a business. And in the early days, I dealt with a couple of businesses. One business decided they want to be proactive. They were front page news the next day. I was dealing with another business on the same day, and they decided they just wanted to talk quietly and only issue a statement in reactive. And they weren't in the press the next day. So it's interesting to sort of see what that looks like. So by the middle, you know, by 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock at night, you can sort of see the story's moved on. And if you've managed this properly, obviously communicated to every stakeholder you need to, but not really had a proactive media engagement strategy, purely reactive and very succinct level of information that you provide. By the time you wake up the next morning, you're obviously dealing with the challenges and the pain of what's happened to you, but you're not firefighting 100 journos calling you and for images of your business or being spread across. But in the first month or so of this, you know, we all saw the hotel chains, we saw some of the businesses who all got hit by this, they were sort of front and center. Now, other than if you're a cluster, it's very difficult to identify specific businesses in the increasing caseload.
Iain, there's a couple of things here. Obviously, there's a new normal of the way that businesses need to communicate externally now, right? I mean, I think that the traditional idea of crisis comms is a crisis only hits one business at any time, right? And then that business is very much communicating and fighting that crisis by themselves, very much on their own. A big change has happened now, right?
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things now is that normally a crisis is us as an organization against the world. We're trying to get us out there and manage the sort of the proposition and what we've done and what the problem was, being honest and open and transparent and relevant and all of those good things. But now this is the world against this virus. So actually there is an element of sort of collegiality across all organizations as we're going through this. And there's an element of sort of respect and understanding that, well, it wasn't your fault, it happened, unless it was your fault. But, you know, it's very difficult to see any organization who's to blame at this current point in time. And so there is, you know, what it's interesting talking to journos is they're not out to really hit you. They're just trying to get as much sort of relevant information as they can. But you don't have to feed them that relevant information. And what's interesting, say, just from a pure Singapore media relations perspective, Straits Times normally has 9 to 10 journalists who are focused on the sports beat. I work for Manchester City, so this has been quite an interesting period of time for me. They've now got 2. The rest of that whole workforce, that journalist editorial force, has been redirected to COVID-19 coverage. So there is really not much space to play if you've got a business as usual story, or you've got to try and push a new product or a new idea. We're a little bit challenged in what that looks like, which goes back to sort of one of those founding principles that we should all be thinking about as organizations generally now and also normally, is that every company can be their own media company. So if the normal traditional channels of how we tell stories have been shut down for this current period of time, because the focus is rightly so on this horrible thing we're dealing with, how do you have your own channels and how can you go direct to the communities that you're trying to engage with, bypassing media, using, you know, your own websites, whatever your sort of internal or external direct to consumer stakeholder channels might be. I think just on one final point on those statements, if you do get hit, your statement needs to be purely very limited, and it should sort of say how many employees, what date they were last in the office, what your next steps are, reassert the MOH guidance, and then reassure everyone about business continuity. Please stay away from our thoughts and prayers. Please don't offer up any opinion around this horrible thing that we're all offering. The shorter and more succinct you are, the sort of more likely you are to sort of avoid being in the press the next day. And just as an aside, every time you do get hit, it takes about costs between 10 to 20 grand a floor to clean. So this gets pretty expensive if you've been hit 18 times. Yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah.
I think that what would be good as well is for us to talk about this new phase that we're moving into now. Obviously, we're all going into lockdown. I think that it's very, very acutely aware from the end of last week that businesses are struggling. You know, let's face it, you know, this is now a real crisis for businesses of all sorts of sizes. And in terms of you've got the external communications play, but the internal communications play, and we'll move on to Suzy in a second. But I do want to get some thoughts from you, Iain, about this in terms of crisis communications internally amongst staff at this moment in time, when your business is perhaps not doing so well or inevitably perhaps failing.
Yeah, it's, you know, having dealt with now a couple of businesses being wound up around the world because of this, you know, they were hoping they could communicate their way out of the problem is the reality. And I don't think we can in this period of time. If you are experiencing a significant downturn, you sort of got to go hard and go early in terms of explaining to the broader world what the challenges you're facing, the decline in revenue that you might have been hit. Try not to make any promises around what you can and can't do for your staff. You're going to have to legally manage your way, and Luke and his team will definitely know more about this as well, but you'll be legally managing your way out of this and trying to sort of engage with a whole variety of different people as you go through the process. So I think, you know, what I've seen in the businesses that have been really hardly hit by this, you sort of go through like all relationship stages of sort of denial, blame, and those are natural human reactions. But, you know, I think you've got to be pretty quick. If you're seeing a significant downturn, you've got to make some pretty hard calls very quickly. Yeah, you've got to communicate those to relevant stakeholders. And then you sort of, hopefully you can either write it out or you shut it down as quickly as you possibly can to save cost.
Yeah.
And don't be afraid to shutter it for 6 months and hope that you can turn the lights back on when this thing buggers off.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Iain, thank you very much indeed. We'll come back again to you when we do our Q&A. And let's pick up here with Suzy. I mean, I think that the position that you're in, you have a lot of clients that are in this situation, and you're helping them communicate the situation. Can you tell us a bit about the situation that you're in right now?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Andrew. And thanks for having me on the panel. Really pleased to be here in very difficult and challenging times for lots of us, and particularly employees. So what we're seeing from clients at the moment is a sense of panic, a sense of a loss of control, feeling that they can't control the message, feeling that the news is running away with them, away from them. They're unsure what and how and when to communicate with their workforce. And they're worried about being asked questions that they really can't answer or they don't want to answer. Going back to Iain's point about the stages of relationships, you know, I think there are, certainly we've seen some clients who are still in a bit of a state of denial and think that they can babble their way through this without making any changes, which is going to be rare for any business, to be honest. And then also what we're seeing, because we have a lot of global MNCs with a presence in Singapore, is how do you then communicate a global level response at a regional or a local level and put that into local context? Because your employees here want to know how will it impact them. Yes, they'll be interested in what's happening with their colleagues, you know, in another country or another region, but how is it going to affect them and their livelihood and their work here in Singapore?
Wow. So I think that in terms of best practice or advice that you might have, Suzy, you know, what are the types of things that companies should be saying specifically to employees at this time? And how should they be saying to them, speaking to their employees right now?
So certainly with a sense of calmness, clarity, humility, you know, none of us are living in a bubble. This is happening to everyone, everywhere in the world. So people aren't, you know, they're not blinkered. We're all acutely aware that this is a difficult time for businesses. So be honest in your communications, be transparent. Don't assume a level of understanding that might not actually be there. Going back to Iain's point, don't underestimate the power of the grapevine.
Yeah.
So make sure that you are communicating what you can talk about at that time. Don't try to assume things. Don't feel that you have to be able to answer all of the questions, because you can't. And be honest about that. I do also think that this should come from the very top of the organization. You know, people want to know that the company cares about them, that is thinking of them. At the end of the day, your employees, without your employees, you don't have a business. So your employees should absolutely be your number one priority. Their well-being, and reassuring them where you can. And letting them know that you're doing everything that you can to limit the level of disruption, but be honest around that messaging as well. And don't be nuanced, be clear. I think clarity in communications in a time of crisis is imperative.
Yeah.
You know, people can take bad news, but they won't forget being lied to or lack of transparency as we go through this situation.
You mentioned that, you know, these messages ideally should be coming from the very top. Mm-hmm. What are the types of conversations that you're having with business leaders at the moment, and what are you telling them? What kind of roles are you asking them to embody? What type of ways are you asking them, or finding out from them, that they're communicating with their staff?
I think we're finding out some interesting things. I think when you have a crisis situation like this, it really exposes leaders who aren't sure how to lead in situations where there is a crisis. And helping them, supporting them to find a way through that. For someone who is already a good communicator at a senior level, this is still challenging, but they will find it easier to communicate. For managers or senior people who really aren't comfortable with communicating, will find it difficult. So what we're doing is, on a client-by-client basis, is, you know, gauging that level of comfort and providing support that matches up to that. So it's very much, quite a lot of it is common sense. So it's listen to your people, be available, so be open, get your messaging right. So particularly if you're within a global MNC and you have regional comms responsibility or local comms responsibility, make sure that you know what are the messages coming out from global, and when are they going to come out, and what is your regional or local response to that, so that your employees here, or whichever country you're operating in, get a message that is very specific to them, as well as the larger global picture. So I think that's really important.
So I think that there's something which isn't really dealt with very much here in Singapore, which is the obvious fallout from all of this. And I think that it's mental health. And I really do feel as though we should have a word about that. We're in a situation now where, based on what you're describing at the moment, we have to be concerned about the mental health and well-being of staff and of leadership at this moment in time. How important is that in terms of strategizing the way that you talk to people, and inevitably after you've told the truth, or you've given the bad news, how do you deal with it?
So I think first, be mindful that everyone reacts to stressful situations in a different way. So you will have employees who just want to talk to you, or just want to talk to their colleagues, or they want to talk to someone about it. You will have other employees who don't deal with stress in that way. They internalize it. And all you can do is make yourself available for them. Let people know what you have in place to support them. So whether that's very practical support, so making sure that they've got everything they need to be able to work from home, making sure they've got server access, making sure they've got big screens if they're doing designing or they're doing detailed work. So there's the practical aspect. And then the psychological support, Keep talking as a team, and I really can't overemphasize the importance of this. You know, we are social creatures and isolation does not come naturally to most of us. So make sure that you're having regular virtual check-ins. Make sure that there is a mix of the messages that you have to put over, that you want to get across around the situation, how it's developing and what that means for your employees. But also don't forget the other really important aspect of being a team and working in an office environment is that, you know, you go to work, you have a bit of crack with your colleagues. You talk about what you've all been watching on Netflix. You have a laugh. Sometimes you have a bit of a moan about a client, you know, or a customer. And those elements of office life are just as important as making sure that you get across the very important messaging around what the situation means and what it means to your employees. So that's really important. So it's thinking about things like what channels are going to be the best ones for you to use. So for us, if I'm trying to communicate something serious, we do it in our team meeting, which is a virtual meeting now, over Teams, where we can all see each other, because I think also seeing another face is really important. You know, you might not feel like it when you get up in the morning and you're sitting in your pajamas and your hair's all over the place, but being able to see someone else when you can't physically be close to them is super important for mental health, I think. So, you know, we use Teams for sort of our regular catch-ups, but then we've got a WhatsApp group that we use where we're doing quizzes or we're having a bit of a gossip or we're having a bit of a laugh. So it's making sure that you've got a balance of all of those different types of communications and also using the channels that are relevant for the type of communications and messages that you're trying to convey. So be really mindful, I think, about, again, going back to my point about people deal with stress and anxiety in different ways. Some people right now will just want to not speak to anyone and deal with it internally, and that's absolutely fine. So make sure also when you're communicating, outside of the very vital messaging around the situation and its impact, when you're looking to do some of the more fun things, as would be the situation in an office, you know, make sure that everyone knows that it's not mandatory. You know, they don't have to turn up for the virtual drinks on a Friday. You know, they don't have to participate in, you know, this week's theme is going to be a stupid thing that you wear on your head. You know, not everyone is comfortable with that. And you know, you still got that mixture of different types of people and different characters, albeit that you're communicating virtually. So I think that's something really important to bear in mind.
That's really useful. Suzy, thank you so much. We'll come back when we get into discussion. What you were talking about their content in terms of like choosing the right type of platform that you might want to communicate to people across, I think that segues really nicely into our discussion with Jules. Jules, you're working mainly with brands. You're very heavily engaged in expressing brand voices at this time, let's call it, and getting the message out on social media in terms of what's happening. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the situation that you're in at the moment and what you're dealing with?
Yeah, I think a lot of us know that, you know, the natural reaction to divert marketing efforts right now is to social media, because offline and out of home activations have come to a halt. As Iain mentioned, there's not much room left with traditional media closely following COVID and world news, right? So I think the one thing that brands really need to think about is to assess, is social media really the right platform for what you're trying to say? And also, are you adding something meaningful or just contributing to the noise? I think also it's very important to act quickly. I think, you know, messages can get irrelevant very quickly given how the situation is unfolding right now.
Yeah.
So I think the ability to pivot and respond swiftly is quite key. So I think in a nutshell, what brands need to think about is how to be more empathetic, more self-aware, more relevant, and more adaptable than ever before.
Can I just ask a question? Yeah. Are you as frustrated or as overwhelmed as I am with just the flood? Flood, my email inbox is full of it, but social media feeds are full of it. You know, it's almost too much to bear, the commentary, the advice, you know, the advertising that goes along with this.
Yeah, I think it's everyone is in push mode. You know, I think the thing to think about is, could you balance it with a bit of pull? Because does everyone need to be pushed this information, or can it be on your own channels when people are seeking out this information? I think that's the thing and the balance to think about now, because I think you're getting the same as me. I get like 20 emails a day about restaurant updates, about how they're doing delivery or takeaway. I think it's important to keep your customers aware of important changes, because you do need to manage expectations, right, around your products and services and any disruption. I think managing that, as I mentioned, with the right balance of what is the right platform, when is the right time, is it push or pull, can people just come to you when they need this information?
I think that probably now's a good time to share some of those examples of good branding and bad branding at this time.
Yeah, I think before I go into that, I would say that, you know, I think being human and knowing your human voice as a brand is important than ever before, right? Because I think, you know, the COVID situation has really shifted the dynamics of all relationships. And I think brands with successful communications are the ones that really know who they are, what their role is in the situation and also in the world today. And also how they can behave in a way that's true and authentic, because consumers are very critical of brands now that are not doing it the right way or are appearing as opportunistic, right? So I think customers can really sniff that out right now. So I have a couple of examples. I'm going to share my screen and hope this works. Can you guys see my screen?
No, I can't. Can the rest of the panel see it? Okay. Shall I share it from mine? Is it the Nike one first?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Hold on. Let's have a look.
So I'll give a couple of examples, both good and not so good, I would say.
Okay. Standing by. Here we go. It pops. There you go.
Great. The first one is Nike. Obviously, you know, a great brand in terms of communications, but I think their Play Inside, Play for the World is a great example of a message that is true to the brand's purpose, right? Because I think Nike is all about unifying people through sport. And I think there's also something very, you know, socially responsible about what it's doing in terms of getting people to stay at home and play inside, you know? So I think this was a really nice tonality, very clever copy, well executed, and very true to the brand. So I really see this as a great example.
That's wonderful. Probably also work for like Nintendo. There we go. Hold on.
I think the other one is another example that I'm sharing here is the Listening from Home campaign in the US. I think, you know, we are in an unprecedented time where everyone's experiencing very similar feelings, very similar physical experience. And I think it's a time for brands to really think about what those hyper-relevant, you know, commonalities are. And I think for domestic abuse, that's something that's come up quite a bit. And Listening from Home is a campaign where they're getting people to, you know, I guess, relate to the idea of being isolated and living at home. And there's both short-term and long-term impact of this, right? The short-term is that people are looking out for these things now if they're brought to the forefront. But the longer-term impact is also that people are perhaps more able to relate or more aware of the issue moving forward as well.
Fantastic. Now let's have a look at the next one.
The third example, a bit closer to home, this is KFC in Malaysia. I think this is a great example of a brand that finds its local voice, and I think is able to demonstrate solidarity with the nation, rising above the competition, if you will. This was a message that KFC Malaysia sent out to all the delivery sort of brotherhood, including competitors like Foodpanda, Grab, so on. And basically, it was just banding them together, encouraging them, thanking them for their service during this time. So I think this is an example of a great execution.
And finally?
Finally, this was very controversial in the UK. I heard that it was unfortunately a mistake that it was released, but it's the Finger Licking Good campaign that came out during COVID when people should not be keeping their hands close to their face or anywhere close. So I think, I think this is an example of a brand that as a result came across as being slightly tone deaf or being extremely insensitive to the situation. So unfortunate for KFC in the UK, especially if it was an accident that it came out. Yeah.
That's fascinating. Absolutely. Thank you so much for pulling those together. I think that they give an amazing insight into the way that people are talking to each other at the moment through social media and the way that brands. So I just want to expand a little bit on what you were talking about in terms of brands trying to be more human at this time, trying to more than ever. I mean, I think authenticity is a huge part of communication anyway.
That's right.
But why should brands be trying to be more human? Why should they be trying to be more authentic right now more than ever?
I think, like I said, you know, it's everyone is communicating right now. And I think brands that really stand out are those that are able to insert the brand, the products or services in a way that really contributes or helps or shows a sign of support in this new normal for the consumer. I think that, you know, this point about human relationships, I think we're all, you know, in human relationship mode right now, even with politics and with business. So I think authenticity is going to be more important than ever before. Mm. I think, you know, it's if I could really sum up the kind of language or tonality that brands think about, you know, it's really about being informative. So basically, are you providing information that helps customers better navigate the changes that's happening to your business and disrupting them? I think secondly is being helpful. Thirdly, being supportive, and four, being uplifting. I think the tonality of uplifting is quite important.
Yeah.
I know it's not easy in this climate, but I think, you know, harping on the negative or, you know, pushing content about regular updates on the negative, is that really necessary and right tonality right now?
That's fascinating, really interesting. And I think that takes us nicely into our kind of Q&A session, where we can sort of have more of a group discussion about this. Now, everybody on the audience, it's acutely clear to me that that we are in a situation where we're going to be running over time. So I've sounded out Luke and Suzy and Iain, and they're all cool to stay on longer. How about you, Jules? Are you all right to hang on for a bit beyond 10? That'd be great. So I think we're just going to run over past 10 o'clock and just get into a Q&A. Please do put some questions into the Q&A. You'll be able to access it by clicking the button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You should be able to see it. I'm going to switch the view now to a gallery view so you can see everybody in an equally sized screen. But I think that we need to kind of pick up where Jules has kind of finished there, in the sense that you know, we're in a situation now where a lot of the stuff that we're consuming, a lot of the content that we're seeing, is extremely negative. And I think it's a good time to bring Iain back in and for you to describe to us this wonderful term that you came up with, that you had heard the other day when we had our first meeting: misery scrolling. What is misery scrolling, Iain?
Yeah, so misery scrolling is what we're all doing probably about 90% of our days. And it's just the concept is we're going through our phones, all we're looking at is misery, interspersed with random WhatsApp images and memes and stuff like that. And I think one of the interesting sort of points is there was a couple of different sort of concepts to this misery scrolling, but there was last year or 2 years ago, researchers at Harvard said that the average human attention span is now less than the goldfish. And if you think about, so apparently the average human's attention span is now 3.5 seconds. And you think about how much content you can scroll through in 3.5 seconds, 1, 2, 3, there's quite a lot that you can get through. And I think, you know, one of the things that we should all be trying to think about, particularly, and Jules will be very strong on this, from a brand perspective and a storytelling perspective, is that for every one piece of misery around retrenchment and the horrors of the world, is there something that we can be trying to do and sort of be positive and telling more positive stories? It's very difficult for some organizations to make the switch mentally in their head, and also from a tone and a sort of a general corporate and consumer communications. But one of the things that if we can just have those moments of delight and popping up and joy every now and then, I think there's an opportunity for brands to do it well. The problem is how do you do it? Because you know, there's so much thoughts and prayers, and I've been told to stay home by pretty much everyone now. Where's the space of which you can play in this sort of non-misery scrolling world?
I have to say that I've pretty much given up on social media in the last week or so in terms of being drawn to it and looking at it and misery scrolling through it. But I mean, I'm sure everybody agree, like my WhatsApp feed, I'm so stressed out by WhatsApp now. There's so many messages, and a lot of those messages are memes. And most of those memes are designed, however inappropriate they are, most of those memes are designed to make me laugh. They're designed to make us share the humor in some kind of way. Is this something, Jules, that perhaps you're seeing being taken up by brands? Is this something which there is a scope for, developing content for brands out of?
Yeah, I think, again, you know, it really boils down to what the role of the brand is and what authentic tone of voice it is. If the brand's purpose or its brand sort of ethos has always been to bring delight, you know, or to have a sense of humor, then perhaps it's appropriate. But of course, not all brands can take on that kind of tonality at this point, as it may come across very insensitive. I think Brett Talk is a good example in Singapore. They've rolled out some really interesting content, but also products that kind of, because they are a Singaporean brand, the ability to laugh a little bit at Singaporeans and their behavior. So they introduced the rolling on the floor, laughing out loud, toilet roll sort of looking cake. Yeah, and I think it's true to Brett Talk's brand, right? Because they're so in the masses and they have a product that allows them to do that. But to your point, I think also, you know, we're seeing a lot of movement of communications exactly to more direct or peer-to-peer channels. So I think rather than just humorous content, I think clients can also think about shareable content formats and what that might look like being shared through WhatsApp.
Interesting. Suzy, in your world, in terms of the sort of the flood of content, I'm sure that in terms of communicating internally amongst employees are very engaged in the external communication from government sources and social media. How easy is it for a company to sort of cut through that and communicate with content internally?
I mean, you can't control what they're reading externally at all, but you can control what you're putting out internally. So just be very clear, use simple language. As I mentioned before, don't use nuance. Don't say "we assume," you know, just talk about the things that you know for sure. And be consistent. So make sure that whatever your leader is saying, so whether that's your CEO or it's a team leader, that is also being replicated by other senior communicators in the business, so that people are hearing consistent messages. And that will leave less scope for the grapevine, because you're always going to get the grapevine, particularly with external. I mean, the amount that I get, I've got someone in my team who loves to share bits and bobs. And I think he shared that leaked press release actually earlier on in the week, obviously a few people down the road. But yeah, you can control what you're putting out internally. Now, how people interpret that, you can't control, which is why all you can do is just keep the messaging concise, keep it clear, keep it honest, and keep it consistent. I think now is a time where you can absolutely over-communicate, and that's perfectly fine, because people want information and they need to be kept informed. And this is a situation that's changing every day.
Yeah.
So that you know, wealth of communication is really needed during this crisis.
Yeah. Luke, you know, we had a little discussion about the sort of the type of content that you've been putting out at Simmons and Simmons. But you know, in your sort of world at the moment, what, you know, with everything that's changing in this kind of new phase that we're going through in Singapore at the moment, do you have any sort of best practices or anything that you can recommend in terms of developing and putting out content?
Oh, sure. I mean, I'll certainly echo what Julia's already covered around considering kind of tone and message. I won't name any names, but some of our competitors have been a bit insensitive in some of the content they've been pushing out. Certainly, you don't want to come across as kind of profiting off tough situations. So although there is a time for kind of direct hard sales. This certainly isn't it. One kind of main consideration that is kind of always at the front of mind for anything that we're pushing out to our clients is starting, I mean, it sounds very obvious, but starting with the message and the objective rather than the medium that you're delivering through. So yeah. so many businesses that want to get a fun infographic out on COVID-19 just because everyone else is doing it. And I think, approaching it the other way around is far more logical. This has been an excellent opportunity for us as a business. I mean, law firms, along with kind of financial services, are often seen as the laggards in embracing new technology and kind of marketing kind of technology. And this has kind of forced us into doing things perhaps we wouldn't have done before. So, we've got a pretty active webinar series that's, again, as Julia mentioned, we're not pushing it out to clients. We've made people aware. We run a daily session on different themes, and people are kind of coming to us for that, which is great.
That's great. I think that from what I can hear, you know, it seems as though all of those things that we would normally do have been put up under a sort of intense scrutiny sort of microscope. Yeah. So the ability to be authentic and human and building a very sort of concise means of communication is really important. And then beyond that, it sounds to me as though you're speaking about speed as well. We've all suddenly, you know, we can't follow the herd because the herd is just misery scrawling. We have to think of things which are different, and we have to do it quickly. Would that be fair?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, as I mentioned in my first point, our kind of content calendar went out the window, and now as things develop, we're having to be quite reactionary to the market. And certainly one initiative that which drives the stuff that we are producing now is making sure that we're still staying very close to our clients. So we're actually leading an initiative to make sure that each of our lawyers are kind of having client contact time via the phone or via Skype, each of them is targeted with 4 conversations per week. And that kind of really fuels the content that we're producing. So we're understanding what people are really wanting to know more about. And then we're reacting to that.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I think that what would be good now is to sort of move into an area of optimism, because I think it's very easy for us to get all down in the dumps about everything. So maybe Jules, if we start with you, is there anything in all of this that gives us cause for optimism?
I think there's something about how I do definitely feel a more sort of collective spirit or solidarity.
Yeah.
Especially in societies like Singapore, like where people tend to be quite passive when it comes to communicating with companies or brands, right? So I do think that perhaps with more people going through similar feelings and anxieties and banding together through these commonalities, that the opportunity for building communities is bigger than before. You know, people are more open to contributing and participating or supporting around them. I think it's also that perhaps people are not going to take products and services for granted that they have for a long time. So I think if done right, it could be the time to really build lasting relationships with your audience, customers, and even employees as well right now. So I'd say that's at least a slight cause for optimism on my end.
Yeah, Iain, you presumably with the work that you're doing in esports, you've got quite a lot of cause for optimism at this moment in time, right?
Yeah, relatively happy with ourselves. We're very grateful and lucky that we're probably going to be one of the only professional sports in the world who can finish their season. So I work for a company, I sit on the board of a company called Blast. We host a series of different esports tournaments around the world. We're a tournament organizer as well as an entertainment platform. And our main pro project or program is Blast Premier, where we go to 12 cities, London, Rio, Moscow, Bahrain, New York, Miami, all fun, Berlin, Copenhagen, all around the world. And we host these events where we have 10 to 15,000 people coming in and watching for 3 days, two teams battle it out, playing Counter-Strike Go and seeing another couple of other different esports propositions. Unfortunately, we've had to shut our arenas, but we can still play our sport. So we've got an event on this weekend. We'll reach somewhere between 300 to 320 million homes just this weekend over, and we can give out. And what's most interesting for us is that we were on a call the other day with a global broadcaster, and they're like, oh, wow, oh, you guys can actually give me something. Because all of the global broadcasters, you know, whether it be Sky or ESPN or whatever, they're getting nothing from
they're
traditional
hungry
sports.
For content, aren't
exactly.
they, at the moment?
And then, so, yeah, we're so quite lucky. So for those of you with cash to spare, do I have a place for you to spend it? And I can get you young, rich kids who are sitting at home, bored, and would love to see your brand being attached to a very cool esports proposition.
Plugging aside, just in terms of like the types of platforms that this stuff is going up on, is it like Twitch and that sort of thing?
Yeah, so it's surprising. Like, so, you know, say in Denmark, TV2 will put on about 12 to 15, and this is like the second major channel in Denmark, they'll put on 12 to 15 hours of content this weekend. On Twitch, you'll have hours and hours of content from us, but also from what they call streamers.
Yeah.
So streamers are these sort of people who operate in the esports world of where basically we could all sit at home, take the live feed that I will give you from our event, and then I'll commentate. And these guys are making really good coin, like a couple of million bucks a year wow. by just commentating on esports, even though we don't pay them. But they reach this huge audience. So it's really quite fascinating. So when you hear this word streamers, that's what they are all are about. And it lives on YouTube, Twitch, you know, there's different other sort of places, local places that it gets picked up on. In Singapore, you know, there's a huge number of fans who are watching this. China's massive, Korea's massive. And what's interesting is there's sort of two trends in this. It's taking, so F1 was really quick when COVID-19 basically cancelled their whole season to put in an esports F1 proposition. FIFA, the football game on EA, FIFA, the actual organizing body of football globally, has its own global league, and every major Premier League team has their own esports team. So they're really complementing it now. And some of our teams, Snoop Dogg owns one of our teams, the Dallas Cowboys own one of our teams, and the Dallas Cowboys team, they live in the same complex in Dallas as these massive, like 900 kilo quarterbacks and these big monster units, and then our like 14-year-old skinny kids sitting next to these units, but they're treated like professional athletes, and they're making
athletes now. Yeah.
Yeah, they're making $2 or $3 million a year. It's likely to become a demonstration sport in the next Olympics. The ASEAN Games had esports as a sport. So yeah, it's a really interesting place to play. But I think, you know, outside of the plug, it's definitely, you know, the average person who watches golf or football is 50 plus. The average person who watches us is between sort of 19 to 25. And they're cashed up and bored. And that's what we like.
Well, Iain and I will be jumping on a multiplayer game of PUGB Mobile afterwards. So if you want to get in touch and find out how you can join us, then send an email. Suzy, what cause for optimism in your world is there?
I think there's a lot, actually, because I think if this situation doesn't tell organisations how important internal comms and employee engagement is, I don't know what would. And so I'm really hoping that people start to take it a lot more seriously than they have in the past, and also see some of the benefits of getting your internal comms right. Because when we come out of this situation, which we will, you know, employees will stay and be loyal to the companies that supported them yeah. and communicated with them. You know, and that doesn't mean only those businesses who didn't have to make any changes, because to be honest, I think there will be few and far between. But like I said before, I think people can take bad news as long as you're honest with them and they believe and they trust in you that you're doing everything that you can to minimize disruption to them. But also being honest that there might be some disruption. You might have to look at team structures and you might have to look at ways of working. But those people will then reward you after this and stay with you. And, you know, it's hard to find good talent. So you really don't want to be throwing away talent because you couldn't communicate to them in a crisis.
Yeah.
So that's what I hope comes out of this, that it's seen, it is given the importance and priority that it should have within every organization, whether you're big or you're small.
I think that's really important. That's a very, very strong message. And I'm just reminded of what you said earlier when you were saying, you know, people remember when you're being honest with them, but people really remember when you're lying to them. So I think that that's really, really good advice there. Luke, for you guys, you know, where's the optimism there?
Well, I think, as I touched on earlier, it's around embracing new technology. And that goes across any number of different things, be it kind of collaboration tools like Microsoft Teams and Asana and other kind of project management systems, which before trying to get anyone to log into an extra platform was always hard. Now people have to. We're also seeing kind of adoption of new mediums that people may be a bit hesitant to embrace. Some of our lawyers are a bit shy to get in front of the camera before, whereas now it's essential we get a few video blogs going and show the people behind the business. And also it's kind of elements like understanding our data. So being kind of out of the office and less able to get in front of clients, we've spent a lot more time kind of understanding the numbers through our CRM to see where the opportunities lie. And that's again, it's a new way of working. And I think a lot of these current temporary situations, whether it's using things like Zoom to conduct meetings, I think they're going to become the new normal after this, and when COVID is no longer a problem.
I completely agree. I mean, I think that certainly our experience at AsiaWorks, we found ourselves being a lot more in demand for advice. I've had so many calls over the last few weeks where literally it doesn't matter whether it's a brand or a corporate. Yesterday it was a music publisher, and the conversation goes, we've never done anything like this before and we have to do it now. So can you help us do it? Can you help us give us best practice, whether it be to, you know, elevate the way that something looks. You know, we can do a Zoom call like this, but, you know, make it, you know, adding some video production to it, is something that can elevate the messaging to a different level. So yeah, it's very much a situation of, just like you're saying, you know, we're now forced into a position where we have to use this technology. So, you know, not every single Zoom meeting has to be a Hollywood production, but when it's the CEO and they're speaking to, you know, everybody in the organization, you might want to think about adding that level of value to it. Or, you know, if it's some kind of performance that needs more than one camera, then you might want to start applying some production to it. And inevitably, you know, these things are more in demand after COVID than before. So I think that we are pretty much there. That's an hour and 15 minutes. So I'm going to ask one final question for everybody. I want to remind everybody that we still have the poll active. So if you have not answered yet, please get in there and give us your choice for the song that we're going to play out. At the moment, Always Look on the Bright Side of Life is winning at 35% of the vote. So if you don't agree with that, I'd get in there and cast your vote. So here we go on to the last question. So I think that it's important for everybody after this long rambling conversation that we've been having to get a sense of what our top tips are, our key takeaways. And I want one from everybody. And I'm sorry, I'm going to capitalize on what was just said and say that my top tip is that you shouldn't be scared to embrace stuff that's new or that you perceive to be new, because you're going to be using it a lot more than you were before COVID when all of this is over. So that's my top tip. Jules, what about you?
My top tip would be, instead of cutting all promotional communications, can you divert that to brand or reputation content?
Fantastic. Ian?
First off, my top tip is obviously call Harrup Advisory. When you get hit, and you will get hit, really slow down, think about what you need to do and be prepared. And this is not a ream of crisis manuals like a lot of us have sitting, you know, in a lot of sort of corporate organizations. This is 1 to 2 pages of who do we call, when are we going to call them, what does our cadence of that issue look like, and how quickly can we manage our way through this. But let's not over communicate and get scared by the process. But when it hits you, it will hit you, and just give us a call and good luck.
Wonderful. You just can't stop plugging it, can you, mate? Suzy.
My top tip would be transparent and open in all of your communications. And that is not just during this situation, but when we go back to normality, whatever that looks like, that stands still as important in all of your internal comms going forward. So that's mine.
And Luke?
I would say reviewing your objectives for 2020. I mean, everyone knows the market's changed. I think everyone can still be ambitious, but being realistic and making sure that you've kind of made your stakeholders aware of what your new objectives are.
Fantastic. Wow. Really great, guys. Thank you very much indeed. I can't tell you how useful everything that you've had to say has been. There is so much more that, I mean, we could talk about this all day. And we will be providing an email address to the audience at the end so that you've got somebody to contact if you want to continue the conversation with any of us about this. And I think maybe, you know, there's definitely scope for us to come back together and have another panel like this as we go through COVID. From myself, from our committee on behalf of the chamber, thank you so